Now, I would like to start the, you know, the revision. Okay, actually, we start with topic, chapter 8 is topic 5, I think, 5, career communication, yeah? If you look at the screen, there are about 5 questions. This question, you will see in your test, but this is not the direct question, yeah? I just change it a bit, and when you answer the test on this Saturday, basically you are not going to see exactly like this one, but more or less this is the question that I'm going to ask you. So for example, okay, before that, in this topic career communication, I share with you all about the importance of applying for a job. But before we apply a job, of course, we apply for interview. Yeah, for interview. And then when we attending the interview, there are some things that we need to do, including the preparation before going for interview, the importance of dressing up, the importance of feeding information to the question being asked by the interviewers. Yeah. So basically, in this career communication, you learn about how to apply for interview, apply for a job, getting interviewed, and then what you need to do after you are being interviewed, and what actually career is about, career and job. There is a different things between jobs and career. Jobs, numbers of jobs will build your career. Career is actually built. Career is built based on your years of working experience, working in various jobs. So that is how to one extent where you actually have a career. Yeah. So number one, why do we place education section of our resume before the work experience? So in applying for a job, we actually send in our resume. Yeah, our resume. I remember I asked you all what is the difference between resume and CV. Yeah? Resume, R-E-S-U-M-E, CV is CV, that is the difference. The words, no, I'm not asking you that, but what, when do we use resume, when do we use CV? CV is abbreviation for curriculum vitae, yeah? Curriculum vitae. So people use resume when they first time apply for a job. Okay, when we first time apply for a job, we send in our resume. But in a career, in a job, in the department or the organization that we are working in, there is a vacant position, upper position, and you want to apply for that position. I'm saying you want to promote yourself, right? You want to promote yourself. So you are no longer sending your resume because that organization already have your resume when you first apply for the job. But now you want to apply higher position in the organization, the same organization, so you are sending your CV, curriculum vitae. So basically CV is about the resume that you update every year, so that is CV. So you see, the difference between resume and CV. So this statement saying that, why do we place the education section of our resume before the work experience section? Actually, in resume, there are blocks. The first block is your background. The second block is work education. The third block is work experience. The last block is every other things that you want to report, you want to show to the employer, to the potential employer. So the question is, why education first, then working experience. Why education first and then working experience? So why it become that way? So why is it that way? Why education first then followed by working experience? Okay, the reason because when anybody want to apply any position, of course they need to meet the qualification. Okay, for example, a particular job ask for student in mechanical engineering, for example, even though the job is let's say pilot. Pilot, betul kata pilot, production supervisor, for example. So to fill up the post of production supervisors, you must have the basic qualification which is degree in mechanical engineering, for example. So that is the reason why education come first before working experience section. Okay, until you have the qualification, then will the interviewer, the employer, look at your experience, working experience. So that is the reason why. Okay, the second statement, which of the following, I forgot to include the following, I erase it purposely. Which of the following is good advice for writing a cover letter? Okay, actually the question, the statement I want to use here is not which of the following. I want to ask you all, why do we need to write cover letter concisely? Okay, why do we need to write cover letter concisely? You know what is cover letter, right? When you send job application with your resume, you must send along the cover letter. What is cover letter? And why you need to write a concise cover letter? Concise mean you write very short, straight to the point. And you are not going to mengarang or write a story, articles and so on. And these cover letters basically have three paragraphs only. Only have three paragraphs in which this meet the ideas of write short and concise. So cover letters have only three paragraphs. The first paragraph is you tell the receiver, the employer, where do you get the information of that there is a vacancy in the organization. So that is the first paragraph. Usually we write like this: Dear sir, the title of the post, and then I come across your advertisement in Utusan Borneo or Borneo Post dated blah and blah. So this is the first paragraph, in which in the first paragraph you inform, you tell the receiver, the employer, the interviewer, where do you get the information. And the second paragraph, you tell the receiver what is your education, why you have the right to apply for the position. Of course you are going to tell the employer your qualification and education experience briefly, very brief, one sentence, two sentences like that. And the final paragraph in cover letter maybe consists of two sentences. So you in the final paragraph you mention about how lucky you are in applying for the job. So you hope, you expect that you are going to be one of those lucky person to be called for interview. But don't write like that lah. Don't write like that. I'm just using informal words. And you write it properly. Telling the employer that you are very grateful if you can be invited to the interview. So this is what I meant by the second statement lah. How actually we write a short and concise cover letter. Number three, what is the right question to ask during an informational interview? Okay, for those who have not experienced being interviewed for a job, I believe almost everyone, yeah, you don't have experience interviewed in the job. So what happened during that process of being interviewed? You are given more or less 20 to half an hour, 20 to half an hour to be interviewed by the panels or by the managers of the organization. So what happened? They start with asking you to do the introduction, who you are, why you are interested, and then you start. The idea is for you to feel the atmosphere, to get rid of your nervousness. Yeah, because during the first three minutes, people usually feel so nervous. So what happened? The panels will try to cool you down, to calm you down by asking asking you to introduce yourself. The ideas of introduction is for any interviewees to get calm, yeah, to settle down. And then only then the interviewer started with killing question. Killing question. They are not bringing the pistol or the knife. Yeah. The killing question means they are starting to bomb you with question that seems difficult to answer. But allow me to share tips and tricks with you all, yeah? Because I'm already 52 years old, 25. I'm already 52 years old. I had gone through many interview in my life when I moved from one job to another jobs. So what my experience tell me this? Okay, my experience tell me this. In any interview, actually, this is based on my experience. I found it very interesting, and I would like to share with you all. In any interview, the interviewer actually did not looking for the right answers. Okay, in any interview, the interviewer actually did not looking for the correct answers. In any interview, interviewer want to hear your confidence level. That is the ideas. When we are being interviewed, actually they are looking at your confidence level of answering the question. If you go a bit wrong, but make sure lah, you are not giving wrong answer. Try to give the best answers. But of course, your answer will not be as expected by them. But try to give your best answer with confidence. With confidence. So, how do we show our confidence during interview? As I share with you in this class, the very important of using nonverbal communication, of using gesture, body language, facial expression, vowels, and so on. These are actually generate the somebody who actually have confidence. If you just talking blah 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 blah, but you kaku, no gesture at all, it is what we call macam robot tu. This is what we call I forgot already. But if you answer the question in interview using your hand, your facial expression, your eyes, and so on, that is how actually people know that you are confident. Okay, so back to this statement, what is the right question to ask during informational interview? So toward the end of the interview, then the interviewer will ask you, okay, now we are about to finish already. Do you have any question? They ask you. Yeah. Now they ask you to ask them back again. So basically, let me share another tips with you all. Yeah, I have been trying this and it proven succeed, and at the end of the day I get the job, I get promoted and so on. Actually my the best time in interview that we should manipulate is when the interviewer asks us to ask a question. Actually, this is the decisive point whether we are going to get the job or we are going to be promoted or not. Okay, in which you need to ask clever question. You need to ask genius question, higher level thinking skill type of question. What is the example? Okay. What happened is, I still remember one of my question is, I tell the interviewer, I said, I did some act lah. I am good at acting. I'm good at acting. So I tell the employers, the interviewer, thank you very much, sir. Actually, giving this opportunity, attending this interview, make me very happy already. And if I am given the opportunity to serve this company, I will be much happy. For that particular reason, I have one question. You see my introduction. Huh? I'm not yet asking question. I'm using a kind of introduction in which actually through that approach, they see my communication skill, my personal attitude skills, and then they are not hear what is my question, but just using that approach, they already, I believe, they already being, you know, they like me. I develop a situation, they like me. They are not yet hearing my question, they already like me. So what is the question? My question is like this. If I am going to be employed, I know the salary is not compatible with my skills. However, throughout my period of working in this organization, I will make sure I will perform well, and at the end of the day, the organization itself will increase my salary. That is my question lah. Because I asked them about, I asked them what is my salary first. Then I respond again to them like that. So basically, actually, salary is one thing that become the highest concern of the employer lah. When they want to recruit workers, if you demand your salary, that shows you are not the right candidate. But if you demand with reason, like what I shared just now, they see something uniqueness about the candidate. So that is one of the question referring to number three. Yeah. Why people willing to do networking? So what is networking? You have heard about collaboration, about what? Public relation, networking. What is networking? Networking means when we collaborate, when we have formed alliances with different people or different organization for same purpose of goals. Yeah. For example, last time during economic downturn, yeah, many banks closed their business, and some bank did a wise decision by merging with other banks, and at the end of the day, two banks merging and started to work as one bank. So basically, these two banks actually are practicing networking, in which their networking means they are sharing the same goal. Only through the merging, the networking, they can achieve the goal. So basically, why people do the networking? Because they have common goals and they want to achieve their goals together. Okay, number five. Which of the following is behavior of effective professional networkers? Of course, number one is communication skill, yeah, good in public relation and so on. And the most important thing when you do networking is you know how to socialize, yeah? How to socialize, how to interact with one another. So basically, that is the behavior, lah. Alright. Okay, so far are you okay, everyone? Everyone, are you okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Alright, fine, sir. Alright, okay. It's raining here. It's raining in. I'm staying at Taman Indah Permai. It's raining. I don't know whether your area is raining or not. Okay, so if suddenly the rain becomes heavier, then problem will be for those who having difficult line. Yeah? So I hope we are not being interrupted by the weather. I just inform you early first that I believe it's going to be a heavy rain, so it will cut short our class. Nah, sekarang sudah jam berapa? 2:38. You see, baru lecture, just lecture already take time. So that's why that is the reason why I didn't want to include games or activities or quizzes. Yeah? So number six, even though you are not yet looking for a job, why do you still have to go to a job phase? In career communication, we learn about how actually we find jobs. One of the ways in finding a job is through advertisement in newspapers, through websites, and also job fairs. Job fairs is an event organized by organization in which employers are invited to, you know, to have their booth so that people, the public, will come in, ask about the organization, and most of the time they also conducted a job fairs. So you can ask about the vacancy, what is the workload in the organization. But this statement, I'm referring to the situation whereby you are not yet looking for a job. You are not yet looking for a job, but you should attend the job fairs. What is the reason for that? You are not yet looking for a job, but you are advised to attend the job fair. So what is the purpose behind it? So the answer is that you don't go to job fair just because you want to find a job straight away. You go to job fairs maybe because next year you are going to look for a career. Keep that in mind. Not because you already graduated this October, only then you want to go to the job fair. No, you should go to job fair maybe a year before, like that. The idea is that so you know what actually the employers are looking at candidates. Okay, number seven, the first information that hiring managers should see on a resume is what? Of course, what's supposed to be in the resume? The answer is your name lah, your name, your contact number. Don't send a resume where your name and your contact number is difficult to be seen. Write it not too big lah, write it average size, bold, because when you write your name, your contact, your address, make sure people will remember that forever and ever. Yeah. So number eight, would you include your resume, your CSR project, if they emphasize your key abilities and attribute? Your senior, I think in 2016, now 2021, 5 years ago, you see, 6 years ago, I still remember the question by your senior, your seniors asked me, sir, in resume, can we put our CSR activities in corporate comm? And then I said to her, why do you want to put your experience doing CSR in corporate communication in the resume? Until you know the reason why you want to put that, then you put it. If you didn't know the reason why you put CSR box of knowledge in your resume, you didn't know the reason why, then you don't put it. Okay? So let me share with you my answer, my reply on that lah. Actually, what is the philosophy behind experience? The philosophy behind experience is that people, other people want to see whether you are socialized kind of person or not, whether you are passive or active. That actually is actually the philosophy behind experiences, in which organization they don't have time to make the new candidate, the new employees to be active. They want active person. They don't have time to engage, recruit inactive person. So by showing your CSR activities, the employer can see that you are such a person who are easygoing, who are active, and very not difficult to affiliate, to accept the cultural values, the social values of the organization. So that's the reason why. Okay, you need to know this, yeah, when you put anything in your resume, because if I am the interviewer, I will ask you, Shamim, I don't know, anybody named Shamim? Shamim, why do you put box of knowledge in the experience in your resume? If you don't have the answers, then you will be given yellow card. What is yellow card? I'm not saying the interviewer will take from his pocket yellow card macam euro 2020, kan? No, actually they will think of you as a person who try to put everything in your resume without know and trying to show that you are qualified and so on, but at the end of the day you are putting something that actually just to convince them, but unfortunately, they ask you that question lah. Okay, so remember, don't play with a resume. You write things that you know the reason why. Okay, number six, LinkedIn. I think all of you know what is LinkedIn. LinkedIn is one of the social media used by most of people in the world nowadays. The idea of LinkedIn is to market yourself. You want to tell the world that who you are, what you are good at, what is your education, and so on. Then you go to LinkedIn. You become LinkedIn. So this is the profile in which many employers are looking for future employees. So one of their reference is LinkedIn. I'm also in the LinkedIn. Yeah. So LinkedIn profile is a platform whereby people search for employment. Is it necessary for you to fill up all information asked? So this is a good question in which not actually you don't have to fill up everything in LinkedIn, yeah? Because there are billions of people, there are millions of people, and employers, if they want to look for candidate, future recruiters, they want to look for a very brief information. So in LinkedIn, if you are using LinkedIn, you just fill up those important things that you expect employer want to read. Number 10, LinkedIn prominently display the number of connection you have in your network. Okay, of course lah, yeah. This is one of the social media part. Actually, I include LinkedIn because this is the current approach through social media, through online, where people try to market themselves, where employer trying to find the prospective employees. So far, so good, everyone.
Yes, sir.
Don't forget to drink.
Yes, sir.
Don't forget to drink. If you have banana, apple, you can go to the kitchen, make some juice. Yeah. Allow me to drink first. Okay. Now we go to the next topic. Actually, topic. Topic. Interviewing successfully. Interviewing successfully is inside career communication. So Ahmad met with the team leader to talk about his recent performance at work and to outline his goal for the coming year. How would this discussion be classified? The key word here is that Ahmad, discuss about his performance. Discuss about his performance with his teamworks, with his colleagues at work. So basically, when Ahmad is discussing his performance, this is what we call appraisal. Okay, number 12. What is the difference between a selection interview and appraisal interview? Of course, selection interview is when managers do some selection who are the right candidate to be recruited. Appraisal interview, there is a point in a year whereby the employer need to evaluate the performance of the staff. So this is what we call appraisal interview. Number 13, how should you respond when an interviewer asks you about a previous employment situation that was negative? This is a good statement. The ideas of this statement is that there is one point when you attend interview, the employer will ask you this question: have you been working before? So assuming that you have been working before, lah. Yes, sir, I have been working before with blah and blah. Okay, then the employer asks again, why do you leave that company? This is the turning point. Why do you leave that company? So basically, people with low critical thinking skill, people who are too egoist, people who are not humble, they will say like this: I leave that organization because the salary is not good. I quit the job because the boss is not caring about our welfare. I'm no longer working in that company because, and so on. So many negative reasons. So avoid this. Avoid this. If that is the realistic, if that was actually happened, you adjust your horror story to a happening story like this. For example, like this: I quit. I'm not quitting that job. I just want to challenge myself. I found that when I was working in the organization, I am able to do more than that. So when your company advertise this position, I see some light at the end of the tunnel. I see some assurance that the position that your company is advertising meeting my expectation. You see how you create excuses from negative to happiness and to expectation, while saying that the previous employer is okay, you are actually praising your the current the, yeah, that you attending the interview for. You see, this is the trick, yeah. And I have been using that trick, yeah, so many times, and I successfully, you know, acting like what I said lah. And then number 14, why do expect recommend starting a job search by letting your job search by letting your friend and family know the type of position you are seeking? Okay, of course, this statement is actually hold on. Okay. This statement actually asking us the reason why we need to share with other people about our possible job, our future job. The reason is because sometime in our life, decision is not about what we think the best for us. Sometime it happens in my life as well. We need others to advise us whether we are choosing the right job for our life or not. So immediately when we have in mind to look for another job or to apply for a job, we need to share that with our parents. If you are not married lah, if you are married, you share it with your spouse, for example. Because getting a job, applying a job is the important turning point of your life. Yeah, the minute you accepted by a particular organization, it is about you and your family, you and your spouse. So better discuss or get their opinions. Yeah, this is the reason behind the statement. And which of the following is considered a good way to make a positive first impression in an interview? What is the following? I forgot already. A good way to make a positive first impression in interview. The keyword is impression. Of course, your dressing, grooming. Okay. There are three type of there are three type of oil, perfume. There are three in Malay we call it minyak lah, minyak. There are three type of minyak. I hope my international student, yeah, you know what is minyak lah. Minyak in English we call it what is minyak? Fuel, oil, and so on lah. Okay. There are three type of minyak that you cannot bring to interview. The first is minyak kapak. What is minyak kapak? You having addict, terrible addict. So you put the minyak kapak everywhere in your head. At the end of the day, when you enter the room with full air condition, the interviewer will run away. So you don't have any interviewing. So that is the first oil lah. The second oil that you cannot bring is the cheapest perfume. Minyak wangi yang murah. Because this minyak wangi yang murah, this cheapest perfume will also make the interviewer run away. You know kan the difference between the aroma of the cheapest perfume and the standard perfume. And the last thing that you cannot bring to the interview is jual minyak. Jual minyak mean you are kelentong dan sebagainya. Yeah. So these are the three minyak, the three oil you cannot bring to the interview. What you need to bring the interview to the interview is your dressing, right? Dressing, grooming, and so on. Number 16, star method of response. So this one you read. What is STAR, yeah? I skip this one. Number 17, which of the following interview question is an introductory question intended to help the interviewer get to know you. Okay, which of the following? I forgot. Let me refer. Which of the following? Oh, okay, okay. Of course lah, you need to introduce yourself. Yeah, as I already say just now, the first thing you need to introduce yourself. When is appropriate time to discuss salary and benefit with a potential employee? During interview, don't discuss unless they ask. You discuss when you get the offer letter. They will send you the offer letter. You can call or when you first present in the organization, you ask the salary, that time is okay. Because they already make up their mind that you are the right candidates. When they make up your mind, you have the offer letter in your hand, it's about to sign, that means that is the time when you can ask your salary. But don't demand lah, don't demand. Number 19, a problem solving interview is not used to familiarize buyers with the product or service they have purchased. Of course lah, problem solving is not about, it's not asking whether this particular product suit you or not. Problem solving is when you have a problem you want to solve. When you choose something that is not a problem, so not suitable. In addition to hiring, selection interviews are used to choose the most appropriate persons for an assignment, promotion, or an award. I forgot this one is about what? Okay, in addition to hiring, selection interviews are used. Oh, yes, of course lah. Selection interview, after the you got the candidate went for interview, then the employers will do selection. Selection mean out of 10, out of 20. From all these candidates, who are we going to recruit selection? Yeah. So when we choose the right person, we actually refer to the job analysis, the job task, the job that we expect the candidate is going to do, whether they match or not. Yeah. Analyzing the need of potential employers before applying for a position is important because it allows you to match your ability and attribute to those that they are seeking. Okay, this is merely a statement. Yeah? Writing across media. The primary form of business communication is okay, basically this statement asking you what actually is the best medium to choose or channel to choose in sending a writing, in sending a message. So the idea is that, for example, if you want to send message to many people, maybe calling them is not the right one, because when you want to send message to many people and you are using phone call, it's going to take many phone calls. So the best thing is whether you choose a letter via post office, or if you want to get immediate response, you use email, because in the email you can send to many addresses, so many people will get the message from you. So this is the ideas lah. Primary form of business is what actually the purpose of sending the text, the messages. Once you know the reason and how many audience you are targeting, you have choices to make. Yeah, to make. Which of the business messages described below is best suited for an email? There is no below. I erase it. So actually, similar like what I explained before lah, in previous in 22. If we want to send messages to many people, we use email. Which practice in writing email would most likely enhance your professional reputation? Which practice? Okay. Which practice in writing email would most likely enhance your professional reputation? Basically, when you email people, one thing in the email that put you in higher status is your signature. Signature here doesn't mean your handwriting. Signature. Signature here could be your position. For example, if you notice my email, any of you if have received my email, I put a signature. Below the signature, I put director, center director for Center of Sustainable Society Engagement. That director is my signature. That is my signature. Who I am, that will make people respect me. And when they receive letter from me with that signature, they feel something receiving that email. So basically, in the email, things like this. For example, in your CSR, when you contacting your team members, yeah, if you are appointed as the president of the CSR, you put the your signature is the president. So it will make your email worth. Yeah. So this is what signature is about. After receiving a hostile email, Jen took a 15-minute break and did deep breathing exercises to release her anger. This is an example of, okay, what is hostile email? One of the example of hostile email is surat layang, for example, or any letters by unknown person, or any letter by known person who hate you so much, who write so many harsh words about you, for example. So this is what we call hostile email. So when we receive such email, yeah, what we can do is that we need to don't straight away reply the letter. Don't straight away reply the letter, because the minute we reply straight away, we actually putting in our responding anger. Okay, so that's why when we receive any letter like that, we become don't straight away reply the letter. Look at reason why it is written to us, for example. Only then we reply. Yeah. So basically, the keyword here is to relax. Don't get anger. Don't reply letter like that immediately. One things under control, then you will reply. And then suddenly, the person email you. Sorry, I actually did not want to send this letter to you. It is meant to another person, you see. So this is the good thing about being relaxed. Okay, which is an effective approach to using social media at work? This one, what this is? Okay. Which is an effective approach to using CCTV? CCTV. I believe most of you belong to some groups where you want to read and don't want to comment. Yeah, this is what we call CCTV. CCTV. I forgot what is CCTV. CCTV. So actually, if you belong to a group and that group is actively discuss things, you should not be CCTV. Yeah, unless that group is actually sharing things that illogical, not true, and so on. But for group which actually did really have good formation, good establishment reason for having that group, you should comment, you should respond, because that is the purpose for being in the group. And then business email should be treated as a form of formal conversation. Yes. Nowadays, many people think that email is like a memo. No, you must remember, yeah, in the email there is to, T-O. There is from, F-R-O-M. And there is CC. And there is BCC. And there is title, and so on. So basically, email is a formal letter. The minute you email somebody, that email is actually a formal letter, and it can be used against you if you wrongfully write something on the email to a particular person. So make sure don't treat email like memo, yeah. Treat email like a formal letter. So far, are you okay, guys? Semua okay kah?
Okay, sir.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, so okay, sir.
Already 1 hour. Okay, I finish this up, yeah. Crisis management and negotiation. You learn from my lecture about crisis management. It is caused by naturally. Naturally, it is not most important thing. I just round up this slide. Yeah. When crisis occurred, it is actually the time where you really not expecting it to happen. That's why we call it crisis. Yeah. And during that time, what happened is we don't have any info immediately. We are not ready. And we don't have a team to discuss with. So that is the situation. So in order to face crisis like that, and also for big organization, important organization, media will straight away contacting the person from the organization to know details about the crisis. So basically, when we encounter this kind of crisis, the most important thing is to stay relax, cool, but make sure you are taking a proper strategy. Meaning to say, don't just leave it like that. You start calling important person in the organization. For example, if you are the crisis manager, you need to get the permission from number one, your CEO, to assemble all the peoples, all the representative of the department to form a team to face the crisis. So basically, these ideas can be used to explain the statement shown in the slide. Yeah? For example, crisis characteristic. Yeah? And then the roles of public relation. Public relation is actually a term being used before. Nowadays, we rarely heard about public relation. Nowadays, people use communication teams, for example. What else? There is relationship managers. No more public relation managers. Yeah, this term already obsolete, but still public relation is practically used to explain on how actually you handle the crisis. In which, when you handle a crisis, the most important thing that you need to take care about is your public relation. Yeah? How you communicate, what info you try to communicate, everything. All right? Negotiation. Okay. I'm going to share this slide with you. Yeah? I'm going to share with this slide with you. So I'm not going to elaborate further this slide. It's already 1 hour. As I said, some of you have Wi-Fi, others don't have Wi-Fi. They are using mobile data. So we need to consider our friend who are using mobile data. Yeah, I'm going to share with you the slide. And if you understand this slide, I believe you already can score well. Yeah? There are some more points I did not highlight here, but just read the rest of the the subtopic in the topic, yeah. But from number 1 to number 40, at least it saved your days. It saved your days because they are actually the question. Yeah? I just modify them. Okay, so basically, now I good luck in your exam, in your test. We don't have exam, we only have test. Good luck in your test. Let me close first, yeah.